Somebody asked Barry if, do all library staff put on a show in the holiday time?
No.
Okay, well, good afternoon. My name is Laura Grunwerg, and I am the director of the Blauvelt Free Library, home to Fine Food and Folly since 2011. And I am delighted that you could join us for our second annual WBFL Holiday Special, a simulated live radio broadcast. Barry came up with this concept when we realized we didn't want to try to memorize 27 pages of dialogue, so if we pretend we're doing a radio show, we get to hold a script in front of us. So, on a sad note, I wanted to take a moment to dedicate this performance to a dear friend of mine, Timothy Patrick Cassidy. He's Lebanese. Just kidding. Who passed away a few days ago, and his funeral is today, and I am missing it because, as we all know, the show must go on. Yeah. But Tim would have wanted it that way. He was a musician and a college professor, and his students and colleagues called him the man who knew too much, because he always had an answer for everything. And I'm going to share with you what Tim taught me about choosing your paths in life. And he had a three-part rating system for everything that you did. You have to ask yourself, are you learning anything? Are you making any money? Are you having fun? So as most of you know, Blauvelt lies within a portion of the area once occupied by Camp Shanks, the largest staging area for servicemen and women departing on ships to Europe during World War II. So to honor that history, our program is based loosely, very loosely, on the concept of the USO show that originated with World War II and continues to this day to bring a taste of home to our troops overseas. And during the intermission, we will take the blanket off of the food, and there will be a mass stampede into the lobby, and you can enjoy our home-baked treats, which are made by a professional local gourmet chef, restaurateur, and also an Army veteran, Aurelio Orlandini. He lives right down the road. So, donut. Leave here without tasting them. And as last year, we will conclude with a caroling sing-along, and I have some percussive instruments that I'll pass out for those of you who want to join the band, and we hope you will join us. So as, without further ado, and very little rehearsal whatsoever, we present, once again, a Blauvelt Free Library old-time radio holiday. We're just waiting for... Can I have that fanfare again? Just waiting for the drummer boy that Central Casting was supposed to send over.
Again with the drummer boy? We tried that last year. They sent us a beatnik bongo player instead of a drummer boy.
Yeah, I know. So I called ahead. And they promised to get it right this time.
Oh, hey! Sorry, I'm late. My name's Roy from Central Casting. Something about a plumbing sketch?
Not a plumbing sketch. A drummer sketch.
We asked for a drummer boy.
Not a plumber, Roy.
Can you sing?
Sure, I got pipes. Yeah.
Again with the plumbing pipes.
Hey, I got this. Look, Roy, do you know anything Christmassy?
I'll be home for Christmas.
Really? Where do you go? Your mom's? Because I'm going to be going to my mom's, too.
He means the song, I'll Be Home for Christmas. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, put your hands together for Roy the Little Plumber Boy.
Christmas is
casting called about this plumbing gig, and I can really use the money because I'm trying to break into musical theater. But, well, in the meantime, I'll just stay here and work at the reference desk and help people with their computer problems. George, I don't know. It's on a high promontory that juts out into the river, and the Redcoats will be expecting us if we approach from the west. I was kind of thinking something like, one if by land, two if by sea.
George, huh? Call me George again, it'll be gone if I court martial. Oh.
My apologies, Commander. It's just that I've got this wacky idea, but it's never been tried before.
Out with it, soldier.
What if we approached from the water?
Say what?
You know, way through the impenetrable swamp at the base of the point. Force an entire regiment to scale the steep and imposing cliff, regroup in complete darkness once we get to the top, fix our bayonets to our muskets without being able to see our muskets, form a prayer circle, whisper words of encouragement to one another, and then attack and take as prisoners the 700 British troops encamped there.
Are you out of your mind?
Well, call me crazy, but I think it just might work.
Your troops will be calling you a lot of other things if it doesn't.
Oh, like what? Misguided?
Well, I was thinking maybe... well-intentioned, but foolhardy. Oh.
I was hoping for something a little more manly, like a badass, or Tony the Tiger.
I got it. Whack job, Anthony Wayne.
Oh. That's harsh.
Well, you're the one with the nutso plan.
Well, let's see you come up with something better. He who stands up in a boat to cross the Delaware River in the dead of winter.
Oh, that's just something my publicist came up with. The last minute.
And I suppose you're going to tell me you came up with the chopping down the cherry tree bit, too.
Please, I was only six when that happened, but he did think up the father of our country.
Oh, that's gold. Maybe I need a publicist.
But you ought to try to get your face on some currency.
Yeah, but all the good bills are taken.
Well, there's always a $3 bill. You know what they say? Queer is a $3 bill.
Thanks a lot. You know, you're really starting to chap my britches.
Well, you know what they say? Don't get mad. Get even.
Oh, that's it. My new nickname, Get Even Anthony Wayne.
On Christmas Eve in 1914, all along the Western Front from the trenches, English soldiers heard the sound of Christmas carols being sung from behind enemy lines. They began to answer the German carolers by singing carols of their own, and one by one, each side laid down their arms and came together in a no-man's land where they shared candy bars and cigarettes and photos of their loved ones, and then they even played a game of soccer. This year marks the 100th anniversary of this Christmas Eve truce, the first and only time during World War I when the enemy celebrated together as one, and we would like to commemorate that event.
Thank you.
Wax Squad Canada Works presents the 1776 Continental Army USO Christmas Show. We'll be back right after this message from Barnabas Q. Waxwad, makers of the revolutionary pre-melted candles that won't trip on your early American furniture.
We here at the Barnabas Q. Waxwad Company know that you're tired of candles that burn unevenly, tilted on angles, and generally produce unappealing patterns of dripping and drooping wax. That's why the brilliant minds in our research lab have been hard at work creating a candle that fits you like a glove. Yes, you, the fastidious housekeeper that simply refuses to abide the random patterns in wax caused by microscopic variations in the candle's surface. We know the very principles of chaos theory send you shrieking and climbing up the walls, and so we're proud to introduce Barnabas Q. Waxwad's pre-melted candles. Let us take the uncertainty out of your holiday season. Available in an attractive white disc to accent any decor, we've also removed the wick entirely, so no well-meaning party guest can destroy your shining symbol of perfection, enabling you to avoid that embarrassing business of becoming a gibbering lady ape in front of all your friends and relatives. Also available in a one-size-fits-all model, which, when placed in your bed, will simulate the warmth where your husband used to be. Barnabas Q. Waxwad's pre-melted candles. One less thing to worry about.
Everybody, this is Bob. Radio hasn't been invented yet. Oh, coming to you over two paper cups and a string. It's great to be here in the Hudson Valley for the holidays. I spent last Christmas with Rudy Valley.
Good shot.
That's another story. Speaking of flags, we got a little gal here tonight who is just going to knock your socks off. Those of you in the Continental Army who still own a pair of socks and aren't starving half naked. But I kid. She's the one who's making the flag you'll be taking into battle. She's not only a great seamstress, but she's also a great songstress. Ladies and gentlemen, with her rendition of Let It Snow, please welcome Miss Elizabeth Ross.
Call me Bobsy, Bessie.
Three?
No. Five to three.
5 to 3. Okay, next page. Take mine, Caribbean, December 13, 1638. Privateer William Blauvelt from the island of St. Andreas is bringing home holiday booty to the town of New Amsterdam, you know it as New York. Sources say he's plundered another Spanish galleon. Amongst the bounty expected by Blauvelt's investors are doubloons, family heirlooms, greasy spoons, spittoons, harpoons, pantaloons, macaroons, baboons, contrabassoons, blue lagoons, harbor lampoons, signature tunes, Easter ruins and snooze prunes. Details at 11. And now, the Blauvelt Free Library, home to fine books and media since 1909, though not necessarily at this location, invites you to enjoy our radio drama. One Judge's Family, the heartwarming story of a husband, his wife, their nephew, and a sound effects man. Judge Cornelius Isaac Blauvelt, whose forebears braved the raging waters of Japan Sloat to carve out a homestead in the wilderness by building a Dutch sandstone colonial home, because, well, they came from an island, they only knew how to build rocks, and they happened to live in the colonial times. It was this Blauvelt family, and its many ancestors and descendants, who made the hamlet of Blauvelt and its library what it is today. In our last episode, number 308,175, young Nat's nephew Samuel made a holiday visit to the Blauvelts at Christmas. This week's episode, number 308,176, stars at Sterling Place as Judge Cornelius Isaac Blauvelt, Holly Court as Elizabeth Blauvelt, his wife and cousin. With Bradley Parkway as their nephew Samuel, Harding Street as Captain Willem Blauvelt, the privateer, Irving Way as his nephew, Garrett Henderson, and Buttercup Drive in the role Johnny Depp turned down. The year is 1843. The Blauvelts are enjoying another holiday visit from their nephew Samuel.
I say, Uncle Cornelius! Uncle Cornelius, the number of trains running by your front door seems to be on the rise.
Yes, Samuel, it does. They are necessary to carry the whale oil to the far reaches of our country. But no worries. 170 years from now, multiple trains running through our town, 7 days a week, carrying many tankards of oil, day and night, night and day, stretching on for miles and tying up road traffic, will be but a distant memory.
That's a comfort, Uncle. The Blauvelts are nothing if not predictable. One might even say we're a humdrum family where nothing out of the ordinary ever happens.
Yes, like the railroads, we always run on time.
Tell me, Uncle, is there not but one lout, knave, scoundrel, renegade, or cross-dresser in the entire Blauvelt family tree?
There may be one.
We always Elizabeth Blauvelt Blauvelt. You know very well we don't speak of him.
Him who?
Captain Wilhelm, the pirate, he's on your uncle's side of the family. Well, come to think of it, your uncle's side of the family is my side of the family, so...
Did you say the pirate?
Oh, yeah, we could tell you the story, but why not have it on video? We can pop it into the 100-year-old cassette player. These things never wear out. I take it by the security camera on the pirate ship. And into this viewing device, or as the pirates like to call it, the VCR. And you know, Samuel, there are parallels between those times and our own, for your ancestor, Garrett Hendricks, was the quartermaster on the pirate ship where Wilhelm Lala was not only his commander, but also his uncle.
My stars! That's fascinating! I must see this video of our dysfunctional family history.
There he is now.
Which one is the pirate captain?
Oh, let me press rewind.
Tibet,
you asked ye, mateys. I am Willem Albrechts Blauvelt, the captain of the seaworthy vessel. Strike sail! Make sail! Labor Day sail. Hoist sail. Hoist the tankard.
Aye, aye, Uncle Captain. Or is that just one eye? Dare I say it, Captain, but you're intoxicated. I believe the nautical term is three sheets to the wind.
It's more like three sheets and a king-size pillowcase.
Do you really feel up to plundering today? Why don't you sleep it off below decks?
Not in your life. Hand me me pirate pants. Hand me me pirate belt. Not that one, the one with the swashbuckle.
Speaking of which, I could use a lesson in swashbuckling, seeing how it's my first time on the high seas.
What's to know? You pull up alongside a Spanish galleon, border by forts that'll loot whatever bounty she may hold. Then you head for New Amsterdam to share the spoils with all ye prominent officials and businessmen in town who invested in ye voyage. That's funny, because I was with Maury Amsterdam just the other day at Hanukkah, and...
Right. But how did you learn, Captain? When did you know you wanted to become a pirate?
Me father wanted me to follow in his footsteps. He was in ladies' shoes. Then a pirate came to our school, and I was hooked. He told our class about the perks of pirating, a parrot on every shoulder. A titanium hook, where me hand used to be. Peg legs means big savings on footwear. Scurvy, brushing me tooth with bilge water in the close company of like-minded men.
Well, when you put it like that, it does sound romantic.
Three summers as counselor at Camp Jolly Roger, and here I am.
What a wonderful and disturbing family history of hijinks on the high seas.
Back to Cornelius. Yes, a great story. In the basis of traditional family song, here, young Samuel, sit by the piano and play. It's the same tune you played for us last year.
Yes, play it, Sam. Play it again.
Up in the yard are the pirate crew, suffering scurvy and Asian flu, looting the galleons of silver and gold. Robbing Spanish never gets old. Yo ho ho and a bottle of rum. Yo ho ho and a bottle of Tums. Up in the yard are the pirate crew, fully insured with a dental plan too.
Oh, a wonderful song. It certainly brings our dark past out into the open and makes us one for the history books.
Yes, and it teaches generations of Blauvelts not to drink and plunder.
Yeah. That concludes another episode of One Judge's Family, brought to you by the Blauvelt Free Library and...
Keeping up with the Joneses can be exhausting. You need the newest car, the nicest clothes, and the best behaved children. Is there time for anything else? Why not settle for second best at the end of the day? Captain Blauvelt's Carob Bean Cocoa. All the richness of genuine chocolate at a fraction of the flavor. Sure, the Phil Joneses enjoyed homemade cocoa, perfectly prepared with vanilla extract and just a pinch of salt, lovingly served by his trophy wife, Candace. But we have it on good authority that Bill didn't vote for Eisenhower. Step off that treadmill of endless acquisition and let the rock roll down the hill, Sisyphus. Embrace your second banana and bask in the miasma of mediocrity as you kick back with your mug of Captain Blauvelt's Carob Bean Cocoa. Blauvelt's, it's barely better than nothing.
And to learn more about the history of Blauvelt's, beginning with the arrival of the woolly mammoth, the development of the Hudson Valley, and the Blauvelt family's rise to prominence, be sure to pick up a copy of One Hamlet, Many Blauvelts. in the library at the heart of it all. In the lobby after the show. Now as before at the low, low price of $15. Batteries sold separately. And be with us next time for episode number 308,177 of One Judge's Family, entitled Post-Plundering Distress Disorder, when we hear young Samuel explain...
Wait, this is the first time I'm seeing this script.
And that's the end of Act One, the WBFL Radio Holiday Special. This is Yale Terrace speaking, and Bradley Parkway answering the musical question, what is it beginning to look a lot like?
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go. Take a look at the 5 and 10, glistening once again with candy canes and silver lanes aglow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas, toys in every store. But the prettiest sight to see is the holly that will be on your own front door. A pair of hop-along boots and a pistol that chooses the wish of Barney and Ben. Dolls that will talk and will go for a walk is the hope of Janice and Jen. And Mom and Dad can hardly wait for school to start again. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go. There's a tree in the Grand Hotel, one in the park as well, the sturdy kind that doesn't mind the snow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Soon the bells will start, and the thing that will make them ring is the carol that you sing right within your heart.
It seems stray bullets are landing in the yards of homes at the base of Hook Mountain.
Welcome back to the USO Holiday Radio Show. And now we have a public service announcement from local residents Earlene and Cletus Cloyd Hickey, who wish to comment on some unusual goings-on at their place.
Ever since they put that there rifle range on the top of the mountain, we here in South Nyack, and particularly us Hickey folk at the Hickey homestead, have experienced more than the usual number of stray bullets in and around our acreage. As sure as my name is Earlene Chardonnay Hickey, I reckons we lives in cantankerous times. And gots to expect we's gonna be feuding with the neighbors on occasion. Bullets will fly. There's no denying it's part of everyday life. But that don't mean that those of us with farms at the bottom of the mountain should expect the weather report to be sun followed by rain and lead. My husband, Cletus Cloyd Hickey, wrote a tune for y'all that expresses our plight in word and deed.
The other day I chanced upon a soldier friend of mine. He'd been at Bluefield several weeks and he was looking fine. They taught him how to hold a gun and when to shoot around. But never did they teach him how to keep those bullets down. Oh, I don't hate to be caught without warning when the heavens are in red. Oh, the harvest rain.
train of all is when the bullets fall. You gotta look up, you gotta look up, you gotta look up, it's storming.
I am gonna murder the bugler, wrap his bugle around his head, and then the troops can sleep in late and miss their target practice date and never cover my house with lead. Well, they close one eye and take their aim and miss the mark by 10. The bullets arc across the skies and frighten all my hens. The horse's trough has sprung a leak, the tractor's tires are flat, and you can stick your finger through my favorite coonskin cap. I am going to murder the bugler so he can never wake up the man. I'll amputate his reveille and step upon it heavily, and then the troops will all stay in bed. They built some tunnels across the fields to get from there to here. When bullets fly, they needn't fear, they'll take one in the rear. But I have a way to make it safe for me and all my kin. We'll move into the tunnels and we'll never move again. I am going to murder the bugler so he can never wake up the man. And then I'll get that other lad who passes all those bullets out, so my home can be safe again.
And Mrs. Hickey.
Oh, we ain't betrothed or nothing. We got what you call a common slaw marriage.
For the child that loves gazing at the grandeur of the cosmos and who also loves eating soup, the Sally Soup Company has a match made in the heavens. Introducing the Tin Can Rocket, perfect for any little boy or girl who has dreamed of going beyond their backyard and exploring the universe. Made out of 100% recycled soup cans, watch out for those edges, kids, they're sharp. The Sally Soup Tin Can Rocket comes equipped with two solid rocket boosters, dual gyroscopic stabilizers, astro navigation supercomputer, artificial gravity generator, particle physics interpreter, and hot soup dispenser. Simply add 1.1 million cubic feet of solid rocket fuel, and your children will easily reach escape velocity and fly beyond the comforting bosom of Mother Earth. Hundreds of thousands of miles above the surface, these mini explorers will take in the wonder of such a cold and soupless universe. But don't stay up there too long, little Jane, as there's just enough power to keep life support systems functioning for a short time before re-entry. After all, 90% of the ship's power goes towards keeping that soup piping hot. And speaking of re-entry, don't forget to fasten your seatbelt, unless you want to be tossed around at 17,000 miles per hour. And you won't be able to hold on to anything with that big bowl of soup in hand. So buckle up and rest easy in the knowledge that 80% of Sally Soup's tin rockets return to Earth safely without catastrophic failures or fatal decompressions. Sally Soup's, we put the soup in supersonic.
Dateline, Fort Hood, Texas, March 1958, where after being inducted into the Army, Elvis Presley reports for basic training.
The donuts in the Army, they say, are mighty fine. One rolled off the table and killed a pal of mine.
Oh, I don't want no more of Army life. Gee, Ma, I want to go home.
The coffee in the Army, they say, is mighty fine. It's good for cuts and bruises and tastes like iodine.
Oh, I don't want no more of Army life. Gee, Ma, I want to go home.
Meal service in the Army, they say, is mighty fine. I just received a letter, postmarked 1929.
Oh, I don't want no more of Army life. Gee, Ma, I want to go home.
The bunkhouse in the Army, they say, is mighty fine. The bedding's held together by chewing gum and twine.
Oh, I don't want no more of Army life. Gee, Ma, I want to go home.
The bugler in the Army, they say, is mighty fine. He wakes you at the crack of dawn instead of 9:30.
Oh, I don't want no more of Army life. Gee, Ma, I want to go home. Gee, Ma, I want to go back to New Mexico. Gee, Ma, I want to go back to Puerto Rico. Gee, Ma, I want to go home.
Okay, Eddie, soldier. It says here your name is Elvis Aaron Presley. What? Ma'am, I'll thank you to keep your histrionics to yourself. So, Elvis, is it? I can't
can't for the life of me figure out why that young woman screams every time I open my mouth.
You can't hear us, sir, Sarge. Thank you very much.
You don't have to thank me, Private. Your duty to your country is thanks enough.
Sir, yes, sir. Thank you, Brett. Thank
you. Okay, soldier. My job is to figure out what you have an aptitude for, besides getting on my nerves. What kind of jobs or training did you have in civilian life that might prepare you for the Army?
Well, let's see. Me and a couple of buddies, we mowed lawns when I was a freshman in high school.
Were you thinking about mowing down the enemy?
Was an usher at Lowe's State Theater on Main Street in Memphis.
And maybe you'd like to usher the new recruits to their barracks?
I operated a drill press at the Precision Tool Company. Hey, maybe I could become a drill sergeant like you.
Very funny.
Well, I'm pretty good with a forklift.
Oh, then I'll assign you to the motor pool.
No, I meant I'm good at lifting a fork. I reckon I enjoy eating.
Good enough for me. Report directly to the mess hall and whip up something for the troops. All right, let's see what you got there, Private.
It's my new breakfast creation. Peanut butter, burnt bacon, bananas on a biscuit. I call it the Heartburn Hotel.
Good God, soldier. Who in tarnation would eat that?
Why, I eat them every day back in Tupelo, Mississippi.
Really? And yet you maintain your slim figure.
Well, I usually wash it down with a Diet Coke and a Dexedrine.
Maybe the kitchen ain't the best place for you. Any other talent you haven't told me about?
Well, I guess you could say I practice the three S's every morning.
Now you're talking. Regulation Army, boy. Spit, shine, shower, and shave.
Well, for me it's more like sing, sneer, and swivel my pillow.
Well, this I gotta see.
Oh, who be the blue Christmas? Who about you? I'll be a taboo. Just thinking about you. Decorations of red on a green Christmas tree. Oh, 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 oh. I made a thing, dear. If you were not there, I'll live on it.
Her number for the show. It's all yours, Miss LaRue.
Picture, Rock and Tyrone.
for you. Ladies and gents, from the Matterhorn section of the Bavarian Bratwurst Symphony Orchestra, Heidi Hi-Ho with her rendition of Edelweiss on the Alpine Bells. Our USO show in the Blauvelt Free Library's old-time holiday radio broadcast.